So, on behalf of the Friends of Pierre, that we organized this meeting, I would like to welcome you very briefly. Thank you very much for coming, despite strikes and all that. 50 years after May 68, many things change and many things remain the same, and that's good. And so, I think there is, you know, the style of this conference. You've seen it. It is commemoration. It's moving, but also looking towards the future, as I think Pierre would like us to be. So, without further ado, I would like to invite the president of Paris Diderot to say the welcome words. And Christine Clerici, thank you.
Thank you. Dear colleagues, I would like to welcome you in our university and Paris Diderot, which is Pierre Benitouis University. It's a great pleasure and an honor to be here with you today, and I would like to thank our colleague for the organization of this 2 days conference in honor of Pierre. We were lucky to have Pierre with us. Everyone remembers the energy and dynamism that he aimed into the foundation of Astroparticle and Cosmology Laboratory following an incentive from Luc Valentin. He was the director of the APC from until 2013. We owe him the firm involvement in the laboratory and our university to space sciences, such as the interdisciplinary opening to the earth sciences, the recognition of the importance of data sciences with the François Arago Center, the foundation with George Smoot Nobel Prize in Cosmology of the Paris Center for Cosmological Physics, and the immersion of the EPC in a global network of equivalent centers of excellence. Its main interests have evolved from high-energy physics, notably supersymmetry, to cosmology and gravitation, and in particular, the interface between the study of primordial universe and the theories of fundamental interactions. Its recent interest included inflation models, dark energy, and gravitational wave cosmological backgrounds. I had personally the opportunity to exchange with him of numerous times, and I remember a man who excelled in his scientific domain, but also was curious about all the disciplines. He was one of the professors whose excellence will have allowed the gratitude of Paris Diderot in astrophysics, astroparticle physics, and cosmology, and has worked so that our university is in this domain internationally recognized. He had the capacity to gather and to convince in the interest of the science, both in pedagogy and in research. Paris Diderot feature a strong school of medicine, a humanities and art sciences sector. We all know that tomorrow, sciences and creativeness, especially in today's knowledge society, is conditioned by our capacity to bring together scholars and scientists from all fields. Bringing together scientists and scholars from all disciplinary backgrounds, it's a big challenge and it's also a great strength. And Pierre was firmly convinced there. To listen to him in conferences was a real pleasure. The last I had followed through the web was the MOOC Gravity, the success of which is from now on international. I remember that he had made so alive, so enthusiastic presentation that at the end of a meeting, each of us was thinking that the cosmology and the gravitational waves were at hand. He had especially given us the desire to participate in the adventure with him. He teaches our physics graduates and gave lectures to wide audience of students from all scientific backgrounds who were inspired by his vision of cosmology. He was a professor who inspired hundreds of students, and through the MOOC Gravity, in collaboration with George, his courses reached 100,000 students. This MOOC was considered by Pierre an avenue for the future. Not a simple way to improve the visibility of the university, but the revolution in the way knowledge is diffused, similar to this of typography, and this revolution meant perhaps a new type of universities and through them a society and humanity. I switched to French to read his citation about the MOOC gravity. Permettez-moi de vous donner mon propre point de vue à ce sujet. Il est vrai que pour le moment, la plupart des universités ont vu dans les MOOC comme un moyen d'améliorer leur visibilité et leur classement dans un environnement de plus en plus concurrentiel. Mais je crois que nous subissons une révolution dans la façon dont les connaissances sont diffusées, similaire à la révolution de l'imprimerie. Et cette révolution signifie un nouveau rôle pour les universités, ou peut-être un nouveau type d'université. Dans ce contexte, les universités doivent faire leur propre révolution. Pendant des siècles, elles ont réservé à quelques heureux élus ressortissants nationaux avec un bon CV âgés de 18 à 25 ans. Aujourd'hui, elles devraient s'adresser au monde entier avec des apprenants de tout âge, origine, culture, expérience et formation. Pourquoi devrions-nous nous en préoccuper ? Parce que nous avons affaire à l'éducation et à la formation et donc à notre propre avenir en tant qu'espèce humaine. Parce que pour résoudre les énormes problèmes de notre village planétaire, nous avons besoin d'une diversité de talents qu'ils se trouvent dans la banlieue de Rio, le Cap ou la ville de Londres, les villages de l'Inde ou la Silicon Valley. Mais pourquoi les universités devraient-elles être impliquées dans cette révolution ? Cela, je l'ai compris grâce aux apprenants des MOOC. Au printemps dernier, nous avons publié la version française de Gravity. Nous avons reçu beaucoup de remerciements et de félicitations de la part des apprenants et un message prédominait. Aujourd'hui, nous sommes inondés par l'information, nous devons la digérer, mais personne ne nous demande de la réfléchir. C'est ce que vous avez fait. C'est peut-être douloureux à certains moments, mais à la fin, on se sent si bien. Maintenant, n'est-ce pas un but splendide pour l'université de demain de faire penser les gens ? Et à qui d'autre pourrait-on faire confiance pour une telle mission ? Pierre Benitru's approach to cosmology and to our university is one we share. Its dedication to excellence goes with a desire to open knowledge to all, to make it more accessible, to make it more exciting and exciting. Making knowledge exciting, such is a mission of the university, a goal we share with you. The University of Paris Diderot, as well as the international scientific community, lost a brilliant and generous man of its knowledge. Pierre was very appreciated by his colleagues and by the scientific community. Your presence today confirms it. Thank you very much.
Good morning. I had the privilege to meet Pierre for the first time almost 45 years ago, and I will therefore give him a recollection of some meetings I had with him in the last 45 years, mainly in the first part where we were the closest friends. So, as I told you, I knew him since 45 years. You see two photographs of him here, one which was in 1975, was taken by a friend of us, which is here, Robert Moscovich, while Pierre was in the chalet of my parents. And the second one is the last picture I took from Pierre in June 2016, just before he was giving the summary talk at Blois. So I met him for the first time in September 1973 at the Lycée Saint-Louis. And then 1 year later, we entered the University Paris Sud and the École Normale of Saint-Cloud. And later, we went for the first time in vacations in the Alps, where you see him with Robert Moscovich. Later, we started a very long friendship where you see us while we were much younger. And In August 1975, we took vacations together. I was driving, and at this time, Pierre did not have a driving license. He was a co-pilot, and we went in the cottage of his parents in Les Rougons, which was a house in the Var, which was named like this because the earth was red. And I remember one of the features of Pierre, which happened to be a default if you are a co-pilot, that he was mixing left and right. He was mixing left and right, and he was telling me, Louis, tu dois aller à gauche. It means you should go to the right. And therefore, we had a small, it was also due to my way of driving, not only to his way of being a co-pilot, but we had a small incident, and we almost had two big accidents. Anyway, we survived and continue. In September 1975, at this time, it was, 7 years after 1968, there were some replicas, and it was the years, for people which have my age, the years of Larzac. People know more about Larzac now because we discuss it with the ZAN, and I went with Pierre to a demonstration against the military camp of Fontevraud. 40 years, as I said, before the ZAN in close to Nantes. And I remember that at this demonstration, Cabu was there. We did not find him, but we found Mouna. I don't know if people in this room remember Mouna, but Mouna at this time was a sort of local hero of the late quarter, and this is a drawing of Mouna by Cabu. Pierre was obviously at this time more reformist than revolutionary, but still he was very interested by what happened at this time. In summer 1976, he was a summer student at CERN in an experimental group, the Omega Spectrometer Group, with people which quoted here. François Richard, I think, is in the room. And in particular, Roberto was organizing the École de GIF. And Pierre went at the École de GIF in September 1976, and he brought me with him. And this École de GIF was one of the most impressive things I remember. There was an extraordinary, to be taken at the etymological sense, talk by Tilly Weltman in the school, which I remember vividly, and Pierre also, I think, remembered it during a lot of time. Just after we started, we did not prepare the aggregation and started the dual physics theory with these people which think are in the room, and we had also Daniel Fournier as a teacher, and just later he started his thesis, and Marie Kay will discuss it after. We continued to meet and discuss and met a lot of times, in particular at CERN at the beginning of the 80s. I remember we went a lot of times to the movies, in particular I remember seeing with him his Soliti Ignoti by Mario Monicelli, and we laughed like mad. And in the US, in particular in 1985, it's the only time in my life that I spoke in the same conference than Pierre. You see him, and I'm behind him. Unfortunately, I never made a paper with him. I almost made it, but for some reasons that I cannot explain it here, because it will harm other people, they did not happen. And later we were, Pierre became professor at Orsay, where he stayed during a long time before joining Paris Diderot. And at this time he went in the Morion Electronic Committee, and I was with him. And we had a lot of discussions with, you see, the members of the committees. Several are in the room. When I went to Morion, I skied a lot with him. I remember he was a good skier. He was not a fantastic skier. But at this time, he had bought from a guy from the French ski team some special skis, some VR17, which were from he had bought in from the French ski team. And with these skis, he was being much faster than me on the slopes. I always thought this because it was a special skis. I'm not completely sure. I continued to discuss with him. We were together in the Conseil Scientifique Coffee and Toupie Free. And he was always giving a friendly help for everything. He had very clear minds on physics and on science. But he was very open in physics outside his direct scientific concerns. And in particular, he was always helpful for all the physics subjects, all the physics subjects. And finally, I will remember he was always a friend of Lal. You see him with a former director of our lab, which is in the room here. He's at the one of the biennials of the lab. During some time, he was almost an honorary member of our lab, and he was always a guide, an advisor, a friend. And I will say a few words about, this is my last transparency, about Pierre as a physicist and a manager. Pierre was, at the end, he was clearly a manager, but among the managers that I have seen, he was one of those which stays most a physicist. When you went to discuss with him, even me, which knew him since 45 years, he was always giving friendly advices, but it was always advices which were dictated by physics. He was one of the people who was really thinking physics, all sort of physics, and more than being a manager. The last two things, I remember from him is that he was in, he invited us in January 2015 to his apartment. I went with Lydia, and he spent, I think, 2 or 3 hours to explain the MOOC. After 1 hour, I just slept because I had completely exhausted. But Lydia stayed with him, and he was completely, he was really, really enthusiastic. And one of my last phone call to him was in February 2017, so 2 months before he died, and he spent 20 minutes to ask me questions, why the LAL is not participating to LISA. He was really still at this time discussing mainly physics. So I think we will miss the man and the physicists. Thank you.
Well, I'm delighted to be here to celebrate Pierre's life, which was unfortunately far too short. I think my title basically says it all, but I will say a little bit about Pierre's early work. There's some people here who will say more about that, but I just want to point out, to emphasize how independent and original he was already as a student. And then I will give some highlights of our work together and finish with some personal recollections. I think it was around 1977 that a young student from Paris came to me and said I was supposed to give him a project. I don't remember the French word, and I didn't know what it was. I had never heard of it. And so I just assumed that it was a, I was supposed to give him a subject for a thèse de troisième cycle, which is somewhere between an American master's and PhD. I mean, that wasn't right. I was just supposed to give him something much simpler. But anyway, I gave him a subject of a thesis, and he finished it brilliantly. And so I took him as a student for a doctorat d'etat, and he became the founding member of a theory group I was starting at Annecy. I wrote in my book that he was a founding member, but then when I was preparing this talk, I noticed the preprint. This, I think this was the subject of his troisième cycle, and it lists Pierre as a member of Annecy and me still as a member of CERN and Orsay. So somehow he got there before I did, and he was the founding member. Then he went on to, he wrote three papers with Georges Girardi on order alpha corrections to QCD jets. And he wrote a very interesting paper by himself. I think that's the title, Summing Leading Logs in Thrust Distributions. And it was kind of a precursor to the modern techniques for treating jet evolution. And then he did his thesis with Thomas Schuker, who is here, and I'm sure he'll probably say more about that, but it was on renormalization scheme dependence in guts, and it was incorporated the mass effects into minimal subtraction normalization schemes, and it was quite a remarkable paper for a thesis paper. It has 91 citations on Spires. It was independent of work done at the same time by Steve Weinberg. Unfortunately, Steve's paper came out a tiny bit before theirs did, so they were scooped. But it was quite an impressive paper, in my opinion. And then Pierre and Thomas went on to write two more papers applying these techniques. Now, Pierre and I wrote altogether about 20 papers. Some of those papers were written with my students. In addition, he wrote four papers without me, but with some of my students. So in some sense, he was not just my collaborator. He was a co-mentor to my students. And so I'll just say a little bit about our work together. In 1981, we wrote a paper called Temperature Corrections in the Case of Derivative Interactions. Now, I mean, those days we thought, people thought that temperature, high temperature phenomena played a important role in inflation. That's not so much the case anymore, but at the time it seemed to be important, and we were looking at inflation in the context of supergravity, and we, where you have non-renormalizable interactions and derivative interactions, non-canonical kinetic energy, and we wanted to figure out how to do that correctly so that the answer you got was independent of how you did the calculation. And then that led us in several directions. We did more work inflation, including inflation in supergravity and finally inflation in string theory. We were the first to consider the dilaton and the Kähler moduli and other fields from string theory as possible candidates for the inflaton. And then as a second direction, well, after our temperature correction paper, I generalized the techniques to what's called covariant derivative expansion of the effects of action for loop calculations. And that was in flat space. And Pierre pointed out that that could be generalized to curve space so that you had not only gauge and other covariance associated with the symmetries of the field theory in flat space, but you also had covariant, general coordinate covariance. And then that led to the possibility of doing loop calculations in supergravity, and that is in fact something that I'm still working on today, which is a direct descendant of work I originally did with Pierre. And finally, we worked on effective supergravity from superstrings, and I will say a little bit more about that. The first thing we did was to calculate loop corrections to the scalar potential in string-inspired effective theories. This was the first such calculation, and was done simultaneously with a similar calculation by Bright, Overt, and Segray. And we went on to write two papers with Sally Dawson and Ian Hinchcliffe, including not just the scalar potential, but also Gugino masses. And in those days, people were studying what was called no-scale models. And what we found was that in those models, there was no supersymmetry breaking generated at one loop, even if there was supersymmetry breaking in a hidden sector, which was transmitted by gravity. Now, in the early models, people kind of put in supersymmetry breaking by hand by mimicking it. The idea was that behind it was Gugino condensation, but they didn't introduce an interpolating field for the conjugate, but rather constructed an effective Lagrangian that mimicked the symmetries and anomalies of the underlying theory. And what we did, I mean, a field for the Gugino condensate had been studied in flat supersymmetry by Veneziano and Yankelevich, and what we did was to generalize that to supergravity using the Kähler superspace formalism of Pierre, Girardi, Grimm, and Müller. Now, at that time, well, a problem with that formulation, if you use the ordinary chiral field as the Gugino condensate, in order to be consistent with Bianchi identities of the underlying theory, you had to impose a constraint on the chiral superfield, which was kind of complicated. And what we the solution to that turned out to be taking the condensate field to be the chiral projection of a linear multiplet. But also at the time, it was thought that you couldn't put a linear multiplet into the potential. And that problem was solved in a paper we did with Tom Taylor and Burgess et al. Now, they did it for global supersymmetry, but we also did it for supergravity using a particular gauge fixing of conformal supergravity. And then Pierre and I reformulated the construction in Kähler superspace with the 4D Green-Schwarz included. Now, the original papers, the no-scale models did not include the Green-Schwarz mechanism, which would one needs to restore the symmetries of the underlying string theory. And without that term, the theory had what was called a runaway dilaton problem, which meant that the minimum of the potential was for zero coupling constant and zero condensate, so nothing, no symmetry breaking, no coupling, which is kind of a boring theory. But if you include the Green-Schwarz term, it turns out there's another runaway direction towards strong coupling, and then you have to take into account non-perturbative effects, because perturbation theory is no longer valid. And this led to what is now called Keeler stabilization of the dilaton, which we worked out with one of my students, Yi-Yen Wu, and that was also done around the same time by Kazis. And this led to a viable model for superstring breaking, which subsequently I studied, we studied the phenomenology, and then I went on and studied that further with my students. And finally, we wrote a paper on soft supersymmetry breaking terms at one loop with another of my students, Brent Nelson. This was basically a update, including loop corrections of an earlier analysis that had been done by Brignol, Ibanez, and Nunes. And so that's just an outline of some of the highlights of our work together. And so I'll finish with some random memories. The first thing that came to mind was that when Pierre was my student, he hardly ever touched any alcohol, maybe occasional beer. But when he had dinner at my house, where there was always alcohol, and I somehow felt that we corrupted him. So I was not only his mentor in physics, but also in drinking. And then I remember commuting to Annecy. At that time, well, you saw it in the picture, Pierre had bushy hair. And there was also François Martin, who often went with us, and he had the same kind of bushy hair. And I would be driving a small car, and I couldn't ever see out the back because I had all this bushy hair sticking up, which made it a little bit difficult. And eventually Pierre moved to Annecy. I still lived on the other side. I mean, I lived in France on the other side of Geneva in the Pays des Gex, but he got this nice apartment overlooking a canal. And I seem to remember, it might have been a 14th of July, I'm not sure, but we were sitting in his apartment, looking out the window, watching fireworks in the canal, and it was quite a remarkable sight. And then, after I moved to Berkeley, my husband Bruno Zamino and I actually spent a summer in the Annecy old town, and it is really a beautiful place to live. And then eventually Pierre moved to Paris. What I mostly remember is having to climb up the stairs because there was no elevator. And we stayed there for, maybe a week, and you had to lug all your groceries up those stairs. At least I was stronger in those days. And then the bedroom was it was slanted ceiling, really, really low. So you literally had to crawl into bed like this. But that was compensated for by an amazing collection of books. I mean, Pierre was a great physicist, but he was also a very erudite and well-read person, and also a connoisseur of music. And it was a real pleasure to stay there and read his books when we had time. And then another thing I remember is stay at Aspen. I think it was 1995, I'm not sure. But he applied too late, so he couldn't get housing. And I don't know if any of you were in Aspen in those days, but for a long time, the queen of Aspen was a woman called Sally Menciper, who was she ran things with an iron hand. She said, Pierre, there was no place for Pierre. She didn't want him to come to the meeting. She didn't want anything to do with him. So we let him sleep on the couch in our apartment, Bruno and I, and he would go out and get us fresh croissant every morning, and we would eat breakfast watching Doctor Who. That's what I remember about that sejour. We also did some nice physics too, but that As I said, he was a great connoisseur of music, as was my husband Bruno. And Pierre happened to have some tapes with him. Those were the days of tapes. And one of them was the opera Lulu, which was one of Bruno's favorite operas. And when Pierre left, he left the Lulu tape with my husband, which I thought was quite generous. And then, of course, we had many dinners, good dinners in great restaurants in the Bay Area and in Paris. These are a few pictures. I never had many pictures of Pierre. I don't know why, but I mean, I'm not great at taking pictures. The first picture that actually is stolen from a talk that was given earlier this year at Morion. It was sent to my friend Nan Finney, who is sort of to the left of me. I'm the one with the blonde hair there. And that was a picnic, a theory group picnic at CERN in 1978. And that person in the white t-shirt is my oldest son, standing next to Pierre. I think they were playing boule. So I sent the picture on to my son, and he said, "Oh, I remember that picnic. That's where our dog almost ate the dog of André Martin." And this picture on the right is, I think that was in the French Physical Society bulletin. And when I found it, I pasted it up in the LBL. Common Room Bulletin Board. I don't know if you can read it, but it says here is a late picture with the lateness totally the responsibility of the laureate. It was a picture that was supposed to be published when CERN won the Langevin Prize. And when Pierre saw that I had posted up that picture, he told me that he got a letter from the French Physical Society that he didn't open for weeks and weeks and weeks because he thought they were after him because he hadn't paid his dues. And finally, at the bottom is the most recent picture I had of Pierre. That was at the Memorial Conference for Bruno in CERN, April 28. Actually, Jean was in that picture too, but there were two versions, and this one is better than Pierre, so I had to leave Jean out. Sorry. Now, in the last few years, because Pierre was very busy with his particle astrophysics collaborations in SLAC and then later at Berkeley, he traveled to the Bay Area a lot, but his travel seemed to always coincide with my travel to Europe. So we were always crossing the ocean in opposite directions. And we usually managed, one place or the other, to have a dinner together, to overlap for a little bit. And the last time that happened was when that year, 2016, I spent a month in Spain, and then I gave a couple talks at CERN in the middle of that month, and Pierre all that time was in the Bay Area. And then when I came back in September for the Higgs Hunting Conference, Pierre was at Berkeley, so we didn't meet, but then after the conference, my son came down. We were going to go to the movie, and I fell in the street and fractured my femur and spent a week in the hospital. And that unfortunate incident for me at least gave me the chance to see Pierre, because he came back while I was in the hospital. He went off to the mountains. Nobody could find him. But finally, he had no idea I was in Paris. And then finally, they got in touch with him, and he came to see me in the hospital just a few days before I went home. And he told me that he had been very sick earlier, extremely sick, but he didn't tell me what, and he seemed just in great shape. He talked about what we should be working on. He was going to come to Paris. You know, I had always chided Pierre for taking on too much administrative responsibility, and he was really happy that he was no longer the director, and he was going to have more time to do research, and he was full of ideas for the work we would do together. And it was a really nice visit. Unfortunately, he never got back to Berkeley. A bit earlier this year, I was sent the proofs of his book on gravity, which was published posthumously, because they wanted me to write a blurb for the publicity, which I did. And the book it's beautifully written. It's fun to read. And I was very impressed by the quotes that prefaced a number of chapters of the book, because they were just an extremely broad range of literary references, which was another indication of how erudite Pierre was apart from physics. And here I just end with one of those quotes, which is, I think it would preface the chapter on black holes, but it's kind of also sums up, I think, Pierre's quest for knowledge throughout his life. The undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns puzzles the will.
Dear friends, we are together to mourn Pierre Bunetruy, and it is difficult to find words to tell our sorrow. So I would like to start with a little tune for Pierre. Not sure that works well with the microphone. Pierre, for the first time in the library at CERN, I was seeing him always working alone. Actually, he was working on his PhD with Marie-Kay. At the same time, I had started my PhD under Henri Rouegue at the University of Geneva. And when I had finished the first chapter on grand unification with exceptional groups, I went up to see John Ellis to ask him what I could do next. And he said, why don't you work together with Pierre Benetrouille? And he introduced us. And he said, well, Pierre Benetrouille is on a hot topic about renormalization and grand unification. And the computations are complicated. Why don't you work together? And that was a brilliant idea. The subject was brilliant, and Pierre had already done a lot of work on it, and I joined him. We computed quantum corrections to the lifetime of the proton, and certainly had a lot of fun. We were lucky to do our thesis on such a nice idea, grand unification, and in a very nice environment. The team of John Ellis and Marie Kay was a nice atmosphere to work in. And we quickly became good friends. And I don't think it's necessary to talk about Pierre the physicist, because his remarkable achievements are well documented. He has written books, papers, there are videos of his lectures. Let me concentrate on the man, and there are three main qualities I always admired about Pierre. The first is easy to tell. He always remained young. I met him after 2 or 3 years of no see. I know that myself, looking in the mirror, lost hair, and all my friends got wrinkles, but not him. He always kept this youthful smile and enthusiasm to the very end. I met him last time at a workshop that he had organized right here. That was the end of November 2016. And again, we hadn't seen for 2 or 3 years. And again, I was astonished that he still had this smile of a youngster. And he said, sorry, Tom, I'm extremely busy. I had stomach problems and have a lot of work to catch up. I have a lecture to give, this workshop to organize. He came to my lecture and we discussed a little, but later he sent me an email explaining all this, that he couldn't come. He didn't want to tell me about his cancer, which is well in line with his personality, as I would like to explain. So, three qualities. The first, he always remained young. Second quality is that he was very good at sharing pain, sharing sorrow. And the third is about sharing joy. So let me talk a little bit about his gift in sharing pain. Sharing pain of others, he was always warm-hearted and an efficient listener. The pain in our cases could be a computational error, or when my wife left me, or when I was unemployed. Sharing his own pain was quite different. He was always very discreet and silent, and took pain with serenity. I only once remember that he was malcontent. His father had cancer, and he was angry at the people that thought that cancer, that there was no help. Well, his father died rather quickly, and I think he was prepared when he learned about his cancer. Other pain that he shared was when his fiancée left him. Well, it was a little earlier than when my wife left, so he had bought together with her this apartment Marie-Ké was talking about, and then just lived there alone in this apartment for a very, very long time. Only later on, in the same neighborhood, he bought a bigger one. So let me talk about sharing joy. There, it was symmetrical. With the same generosity and enthusiasm, he shared the joys of others and his own joy. And I think that these two gifts, sharing pain and sharing joy, made him this extraordinary teacher he was. Sharing joy, in our case, was when we got a computation correct, or his joy when Mitterrand was elected president, his joy when he got very early on his first permanent position. He was the first permanent theoretician hired in Annecy. I think it was even before he finished his PhD in Orsay. Well, this sharing of pain and of joy made him this good teacher. Just one little story about his view on teaching. He had this CNRS position in Annecy, no teaching, and had this beautiful apartment in Annecy. We've seen the picture. And one of the joys that he enjoyed thoroughly was outdoor activities. We skied together. Well, we already talked about his skis. He had these extremely long skis that were not fashionable anymore at this time, and an extremely elegant style, body language. He was always discreet with his body language, but when he was skiing, it became obvious how much he enjoyed skiing and other outdoor activities. One of my best memories is certainly when we canoed down the Versoix. The Versoix is a small river that goes into the Lake Geneva in the little city called Versoix. It is along the, it's coming from the Jura and flowing along the French-Swiss border. And we went down, beautiful sunny day, this river, and we were both happy. Other outdoors activities he enjoyed, sailing. Unfortunately, we never sailed together. He was always busy when he came to Marseille. I have a little sailboat, and we always said we must go sailing together. He said, yes, yes, but not this time. I have to go back immediately. I have this meeting to sit on in Paris. And to be more specific, he came to a cosmology conference in June 2003. And he was the final reviewer of that conference. But he had this meeting in Paris on Wednesday. So for 2 days he was absent. And still he managed to do a good review. He got all the transparencies of the talks he missed and made a review. So no time for sailing. And we always said later we'll do it. Then he was very much involved at the university, and I was happy when he quit being president or head of whatever section he was. Said, now will be time for sailing. Never. I said, well, soon we'll be retired and then we'll go sailing. But that never happened. Other activities where we shared joy was when we cooked together. We went to the movies or listened to music. He was very fond of opera. And I thought he was happy being happy with outdoor activities, to be in Annecy, which is right in the center of mountains, rivers, lakes. But no, he spent most of his weekends in Paris. Paris was his true love. His family, his friends were in Paris, and the opera and this cultural life. He missed a lot, and so also this joy he shared when we came to Paris. He was always a very generous guide and found really a nice little theater or a nice little cinema to see a film that we couldn't see in Geneva. So he loved nature and being outdoors, but his real heart was in big cities, not only Paris. He liked Los Angeles, San Francisco. I don't like big cities. But he convinced me that Paris had hidden charms. And in the same way, he convinced me that I should not say I don't like Los Angeles, it's too big. He said, no, you cannot love a big city. You can appreciate a certain neighborhood here, a certain neighborhood there. Don't look at it globally. Well, other outdoor activities, tennis. He had an apartment when he, at the very beginning, before he settled in Annecy, he rented a flat in Saint-Genis. And that flat came with a common tennis court. So he invited me over. We played tennis a little bit. But we were both lousy. And still, since we had the same degree of lousiness, we enjoyed it. But then his mother came down once, and she was a good tennis player. So she played the two of us simultaneously. And that certainly was fun for the three of us. So the three qualities I admired with him: his youth, his gift to share joy, and his gift to share pain. For the sake of equilibrium, I must also say something that I didn't like. I already said it, but he was working too much. He had no measure. He couldn't say, no, I need more time for my personal joy. And I always regretted it, as Marie Kay were traveling this way. He was traveling so much, and even when he came to Marseille, it was difficult to get a hand on him. And he always promised, when I'm done with this job, then we'll have more time. Thank you.
So this message has been sent to us by Nani and Suzy, two secretaries from Saint-Tiège that every particle theorist knows and also many experimentalists. And we will show they have known Pierre very well. We will show their slides. And to make it maybe more lively, we'll also read them. So will there be many non-physicists talking about Pierre? We wanted to profit from this occasion to say, as colleagues of a different kind, how charming and funny he was to us, how easy to speak to. He is the first physicist with whom young Nani hit it off as soon as he arrived in the division in 1979. Of course, he was liked by all, as he was so pleasant and sympathetic. On the other hand, Suzy was already seasoned when she looked after his thesis in 1980. She was then working in the Seine typing service, and some members of TH division were their clients. Pierre was 25, already full of wit and charm, and he had tons of kindness. An instance of this is what he inserted in the acknowledgments for his thesis, where he wrote, j'aimerais terminer par un petit conte. Il était une fois à la cour du roi, un petit bébé nommé Manuscrit, qui, à sa naissance, était loin de la perfection, à peu près muet, couvert de boutons. Peu avant son baptême, trois bonnes fées arrivèrent à la cour. La première s'approcha du berceau et lui donna la parole. Les deux autres se réunirent pour lui donner la beauté. Les bonnes fées s'appellent Suzy Vascotto, Marie-Noël Pagès et Marinette Glomet du service publication du CERN. So this was written in acknowledgement of the thesis, and this was to thank the secretaries who had typed the thesis. Apart from thanking us for the work we had put into producing the thesis, which was quite usual, this paragraph was so neat and special, wasn't it? And typical of the fact that he never did things quite like everybody else. We both saw a lot of people come and go at CERN, within TH division or through the pool, pleasant people, indifferent ones, and even some objectionable. Pierre, however, was one of those who stayed in our memory and heart, even though we had seen less of him for a long time, and certainly less still in recent years. The shock of his death was that much more brutal that we had heard nothing of what he had been through, and had overcome in the last months. He was discreet and even secretive. We knew nothing of his life, of his family, except that he had been born in Morocco and had lived part of his childhood in Fontenay-aux-Roses. When he left CERN for the first time at the end of 1980, it was to do his compulsory military duties. The division had organized a little fête for him, for which Tania had drawn this lovely invitation, which you can read here, As for most people, even if they usually keep only the good moment in their mind, it was not an easy and pleasant time he had in the army. Emilien.
Okay, so I think I'll take over from Stefan to continue, since it's a bit long. About this, the army, he said that about a fortnight after his incorporation, he wrote to the secretary and said, voilà 15 jours du dépassé. Heureusement que j'ai une permission le week-end passé parce que j'ai commencé à oublier comment était fait le monde de l'autre côté du mur de la caserne. However, he made the most of it and learned some stupefying, awful, useful lessons such as this one. Savoir se tirer d'une explosion nucléaire, donc se coucher, puis après coup prendre une douche en se rinçant bien. So he learned a lot of useful things. He had to do with some people like he had never come across before, some astonishing. Here is what a direct superior told him in a moment of confidence. I'm not sure I read the last word. Comme les fêtes de Noël approche, je vais vous gâter. Je vais vous livrer la pensée de la semaine. Confession d'un adjudant. Si mon fils ne voulait pas faire son service militaire, je n'aurais plus qu'à me couper. As he grew older, his qualities, sparking intelligence, awareness, wittiness, kindness, spontaneous charm, availability never tarnished, and this was still defining him after he had become the first director of the Astroparticle and Cosmology Laboratory created in France 2005. After that, we just had his visits from time to time, always too short. We never let pass any of these occasions of seeing him, at least for a coffee together and sometimes for a meal. So some of the photos Nani sent us during one of his visits in September 2007, Nani and Pierre in Chambézy. In the years that followed, Nani had other occasions to see him around the world. For instance, when he attended the conference when she was working too in Vietnam in 2013. So that's about the inauguration of the Physics Center in Quignon. Susie was turning 71 that month, so they sent her this lovely picture showing with Guido Martinelli the number of her years. So there are several photos, as you see, one of them with me and Pierre here in Vietnam. The memory we have of Pierre is indelible, even if we know that his departure is definitive this time. After the violent shock we felt a year ago, our sorrow is today as deep as was the pleasure of seeing him every time. This will never fade away. So that's the last part of the message of Susie Nani.
So when I met Pierre for the first time, that was at CERN in 1980. And this was not in the library, it was in the cafeteria. And he was working on jets with Georges Girardi at that time, and we talked about physics, and we discussed merits of various theories, and we may have been talking a little bit about Technicolor, and I'm sure we were talking already about supersymmetry, because I was working on supersymmetry at that time, and I certainly told him that it was a great theory. And so he was at CERN, and he was working with Marie Kay in Annecy, and then there was a problem with the Annecy group, because apparently it was a great place to be in Annecy, and many French people from CNRS were coming from various French labs to Annecy, and they were staying there, and they didn't want to go back to their original laboratories. And therefore, the commission du CNRS decided that the things shouldn't stay that way, and not too many people should stay in Annecy, and the number of people in Annecy had to be limited to 4 people. But they didn't say who were the 4 people who should be admitted to stay there. And of course, a small group of people was designated in order to choose the four who could stay among probably seven. I was in this group to do the bad work. And of course, I mean, Pierre was there, and it was a great guy. It was clear he was going to have a great future, and he was obviously, without discussion, decided that he should stay. And other people, of course, it was decided that they should stay. And we were supposed to shoot four, to choose four, but we cheated a little bit. We chose five. But this makes no difference, because anyway, at the end, everybody stayed in Annecy. It makes no difference. And after that, other people keep coming to Annecy. And there was a great group, and then later it became a laboratory. It became the Lab TH, and it became the ANSI laboratory, which is a fantastic laboratory, thanks to Marie-Kay and other person in ANSI. Great. Another thing for which Pierre played an essential role, I mean, he was the founder of the GDR supersymmetry. And when he talked to me about that in the 90s, he was saying that, well, there are many people interested in supersymmetry, and we could do this, we could do that, and we could build this thing, and a large number of people would be interested. He was talking to me about, I don't know, maybe 100 persons. And I couldn't believe it. I said, no, it's not possible. There are not so many people believing, I mean, ready to go in this thing, in this GDR. And it was strange to me. And he said, yes, yes, I know it will work, blah, blah. And he did it, and it worked, and it was a great time. And we had this GDR, and all these working groups within the GDR, and all these meetings, and it was a great time. And I'm sure there are many people in the room who remember very well this period, and working on supersymmetry, and the new thing was to have the experimentalists and theoreticians talking to them together and thinking about new ways of searching experimentally for supersymmetry. And one of the results, at least for me, of this is writing, which was sometimes a little bit painful, of this physics reports on R parity violating supersymmetric theories, which was a thick thing, which is a little bit hard to write and to finish, but we were very happy to do it, and it's still useful now, I think. And then also, I mean, as you know, he was very much involved in astroparticle, in space projects, and he was submitting to CNES a number of projects for testing gravitational waves in space and LISA and so on, and many, many projects at the same time. And I was at that time in the committees in CNES. And when I was adding on this project, he was supposed to add 30% of this time. And on that project, it was supposed to work 40% of these times, and I could determine that Pierre was certainly working more than 200% of this time altogether. So, I mean, he did a huge number of things. I mean, older people will talk about all aspects of what he did, but for me, those was the main things and the main memories. I mean, and I will remember him always for his enthusiasm and for all the things he brought to us, for our community as a whole. Thank you.
Regarding this, I would like to tell you a short anecdote that involves four of us. So 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, when Pierre was approaching 60, so it was in 1 year before, in fact, three of his former PhD students, Emilien Douda, Cédric de Fanye, and me, together with David Langlois, we think that we have to organize something for his 60th birthday. And we even started to think of a list of potential speakers, and we started to think how we would organize that. And just after that, we sent an email to Pierre to tell him about that and to ask him about his opinion about the speakers we wanted to invite. And his answer was absolutely negative. He said, no, not for me. I don't like these celebrations at all. I don't like to look towards the past, but rather towards the future. And he added, at the end, he thanks us, of course, for having thought of that, but he didn't want to do that. And at the end of his message, he wrote us, shall we talk about it in 10 years from now? We continue now with the personal recollections, and François Richard from Lalle Orsay will talk about his recollections from Pierre.
Merci beaucoup pour l'invitation, qui est pour moi très émouvante. Je suis bien loin d'avoir les mêmes titres à parler de Pierre que ceux que vous avez entendus ce matin. Néanmoins, les organisateurs ont jugé que j'étais invitable, et donc je vais essayer de m'acquitter de ma mission du mieux possible. Comme je suis timide, j'ai écrit un peu ce que je vais vous dire pour essayer de dire le moins de bêtises possible. Et je vais d'abord, évidemment, vous dire que c'est un honneur pour moi de dire ces quelques mots au sujet de Pierre Binetruy. Je n'ai pas l'intention de parler beaucoup de souvenirs personnels. J'ai surtout croisé Pierre Binetruy dans les activités type GDR Suzy, préparation d'une future machine et plus et moins, et autres. Mais c'est pas mon cas personnel qui est en cause, mais c'est plutôt ma vision, ma perception de Pierre que je voudrais essayer de vous transmettre. Je l'ai rencontré, comme l'a dit si bien Louis Fayard, en 76, ce qui fait déjà un certain temps. Et effectivement, je travaillais à cette époque en compagnie notamment de Sonderegger et de Daniel Treille au CERN. Et nous avons, il a fait son stage auprès du spectromètre Oméga. Rappelons que cette période, évidemment, était particulièrement cruciale, non pas la physique que nous faisions à l'Oméga, mais ce qui se passait, évidemment, aux États-Unis avec les fabuleuses découvertes et auxquelles, évidemment, il était très sensible. Donc, c'était une période, c'était un triomphe incontesté qui s'était déroulé après la découverte des courants neutres, un triomphe incontesté de ce que nous appelons le modèle standard, et cela entraîna d'importantes révisions dans ce qu'on pourrait appeler la doxa cernoise, qui n'était pas du tout orientée vers cela, mais ça je ne le rappellerai pas non plus. Pierre hésitait encore, je crois, entre la théorie et l'expérience, et il semble que nous ne l'ayons pas convaincu de devenir expérimentateur. Je crois que nous avons donc joué un rôle très positif. Et il semble que je n'éprouve pas de regret au vu de sa belle carrière, évidemment, de théoricien, qu'il a mené, tout en restant très attentif, je dois dire, aux aspects expérimentaux de notre discipline. Et nous avons constamment bénéficié de ses conseils, mais ça, tout cela a déjà été fort bien dit. Comme le montre ta carrière, cher Pierre, tu as su concilier ce qui d'habitude ne l'est pas. Être au contact des spéculations les plus novatrices, source d'inspiration pour tracer le chemin des expériences sur accélérateur et des observations de l'univers. C'est ça qui caractérise vraiment ta mission et ta réussite. Ces deux aspects étant inséparables, les inséparables outils de la connaissance des lois de la nature, et tu ne les as pas séparés, contrairement à beaucoup de gens. Ces deux outils marchent ensemble. Tu as porté la bonne parole auprès des décideurs en participant à de nombreux comités. C'est aussi une mission très importante dont tu t'es fort bien acquitté, où se détermine la stratégie scientifique. Tu as formé de jeunes chercheurs par des écoles et des séminaires, cela a été dit également. Tu as finalement franchi le pas en créant ton laboratoire, et nous sommes tout près de ton laboratoire, et que je suis content de saluer. Cher Pierre, toi qui as exploré avec audace et imagination les vertiges des deux infinis, dont parle le grand Pascal, tu nous manques, parce que nous sommes un peu perdus en ce moment, et je vais essayer de développer ce point. Deux grandes découvertes récentes ont marqué mon laboratoire, le laboratoire de l'accélérateur linéaire, celle du boson qu'on appelle BEH, pour être bien complet, et celle plus récente des ondes gravitationnelles. Elles ont occupé, je crois, ne pas me tromper en disant qu'elles ont occupé l'essentiel de tes préoccupations, la supersymétrie étant encore à découvrir. Certes, la découverte du boson BEH comble les orthodoxes, qui voudraient que ce soit la fin, notamment ceux qui nous financent, du modèle de notre discipline, les orthodoxes donc du modèle standard, et complète la suite des découvertes magnifiques qu'il a accompagnées depuis un demi-siècle. Cette découverte n'est qu'un nouveau début, en fait, car elle provoque toutes sortes de questions nouvelles. Est-ce une particule élémentaire, seule de son espèce, seule scalaire de son espèce, ou une particule composite? Est-elle reliée au champ primordial qui régit l'inflation, etc., etc. Toutes questions que nous nous posons et auxquelles nous n'avons aucune réponse jusqu'à maintenant. Nous restons totalement désemparés quand il s'agit de relier infiniment petit et infiniment grand, et le boson de Higgs, à mon avis, est le point de rencontre, et la crise actuelle que nous traversons ressemble beaucoup à celle des débuts du siècle précédent, en remplaçant le mot « éther » par celui d'énergie du vide et en constatant avec désespoir que nous n'avons pas su marier la physique des particules et la gravitation. Non plus que nos prédécesseurs n'avaient pu réunir Maxwell et Newton. Non, on n'a pas avancé sur ce terrain, je suis prêt à être contredit. Beaucoup espéraient que le LHC confirmerait la vision théorique prévalente, dont tu as été un acteur important, et que l'on découvrirait un monde nouveau de particules supersymétriques. On a attendu au LEP, maintenant on attend au LHC, on attend Godot. Et Godot n'arrive pas. Qui donnerait une interprétation d'un boson de Higgs élémentaire compatible avec l'échelle de Planck, le problème connu sous le nom de naturalité auquel tu as fait très souvent référence dans tes exposés. Ce n'est pas encore le cas et nos accélérateurs restent muets à ce sujet. De leur côté, les expériences de recherche de matière noire ne sont pas dans une situation très glorieuse. Je me tourne vers un expert en face, et elle n'arrive plus à couvrir le champ vertigineux d'hypothèses de masse proposées, des actions de moins d'un micron électrovolt à des trous noirs macroscopiques. Donc nous ne savons pas non plus là où nous allons. Tu avais compris que nous étions entrés dans une ère où les réponses aux grandes questions de la physique fondamentale ne peuvent être abordées séparément par ce qu'on appelle des toy models, ne réglant qu'un secteur de la physique. Donc des observations partielles, mais doivent être abordées par des théories aussi complètes et réalistes que possible. Tu as beaucoup insisté là-dessus. Nous devons dépasser la présente description en deux mondes distincts, l'infiniment petit et l'infiniment grand, à savoir la relativité générale non quantifiée et la théorie quantique du modèle standard. Tu as toujours visé ce but, espérant que la théorie des supercordes parviendrait à unifier particules élémentaires et gravitation, qu'elle répondrait aux énigmes de la matière cachée et des champs scalaires qui semblent régir l'univers, tel le boson BEH, mais pas seulement lui. Il y a aussi l'énergie noire, le champ d'inflation des débuts de l'univers, ou l'action, particules inventées pour réguler les interactions fortes. Ces particules paraissent bien isolées et elles sont difficiles à relier. Résoudre ces énigmes exige sans doute une meilleure compréhension de ce que nous appelons le vide quantique. Tu nous manques donc. Nous ne sommes pas arrivés au port et nous avions encore besoin de toi de longues années. Mais la fatalité a voulu que tu nous quittes. Nous voudrions partager avec toi ces interrogations encore et encore. Nous voudrions que tu nous guides dans ce labyrinthe où nous errons à la recherche d'une explication satisfaisante de notre univers. Pour conclure, j'adresse à ta famille, à tes amis et à tes collègues toutes mes chaleureuses condoléances. Merci beaucoup.